the wonders of outer space, the planets, the moon, the sheer scale of it all. It is enough to make me want to wish upon a star.
Welcome to Neverland!
Take a star to the right and stay until morning. Neverland.
Good morning, Neverland!
Happy New Year, or happy 2015, however you want to look at it, because you might be looking at your Back to the Future calendar and saying, where is my hoverboard and my flying car? Because yes, it is 2015, but you know, it's not quite October 15th yet, so we still have time to have your hoverboard, and also your jacket that dries itself. But this is the Neverland Podcast, and I am Jeremy, I am the Pan, and it's time to bring you a really, really great show this week. I'm having a bit of a change of plan. You know, we had planned like a long time ago that we were going to maybe do a bucket list or a New Year's resolution and everything. But it seems everybody does that. So I kind of wanted to get on with maybe a bit of more business as usual. And we did have something interesting, though, that happened within the last couple of weeks. On December the 22nd, we lost a dear voice actor who's done work for Disney. She was Goslin on Darkwing Duck, Christine Cavanugh. She's also got a lot of other work, and you're going to be very familiar with some of her work. And so I thought it would be fun to dedicate an episode to some of her work. And so I've assembled a panel here. We're going to talk to Jason from DAF Radio, Gary from Saturday Morning Rewind, and also voice actress Katie Leigh, who was one of our previous guests. You'll remember her as being Honker on Darkwing Duck, also as Sunny Gummi, and a host of other characters. And if you're not familiar with some of her work, she was even Rolf the Dog on Muppet Babies. If you're not familiar with her work, go back and check on whatever episode it was. It was pretty early on, but go back and check it out. She was on the Neverland Podcast. We talked about her career and everything, and she's always a lot of fun. And so I gathered them together. I've got a great audio. We had a great conversation, and I'm going to share that with you. And hopefully you're all going to enjoy it. I enjoyed talking to them. I had a good time talking to them. We talked a little bit about Christine's career and then branched off into talking about how we enjoy the cartoons as a child and how much those mean to us and how they can still hold a special place in our hearts as we grow up. So it's a really great discussion. I think you're going to enjoy it. It really hits that theme of what we're all about here at Neverland. But speaking of the Neverland Podcast, I do need to get a little bit of information to you. I'm having a bit of a life change here this year. I have taken a new position with the Ford Motor Company, and due to the schedule I'm going to have coming up by the end of this month, we're going to have a different time frame for when the Neverland Podcast will be available for you to download. Normally, I've had them ready, Sunday afternoon, so it's ready for your work week on Monday morning. But that's not going to happen by the end of the month, or probably maybe I guess first week in February is when it's really going to kick in. It'll start coming out midweek, say maybe Wednesday or Thursday. So it's a bit of a change, but we will continue on. Just make sure you're subscribed on iTunes, Stitcher, or Blueberry, so you whenever those new episodes come out, of course, you will know. And of course, if you're following us on Twitter at NeverlandPcast or following us on Facebook, facebook.com/NeverlandPodcast, we also do have a Facebook group that you can be a part of. If you're following in all of those areas, I will make sure that we are posting in those areas, although I guess Facebook is getting a little weird and they might not necessarily let you see it, so you might actually have to look each time. But if you're subscribed on one of the prescribed areas, then you will of course know when every new episode comes out, and so you will not miss a thing. And make sure you're telling everybody, of course, about these episodes and how much fun we're having at Neverland. And also do not forget to visit neverlandpodcast.com. You can find all the information you could possibly want. We do have a news page, which is kind of a blog I have not updated in a while. We have some photos, some cosplay, and things like that. And also on the website, make sure you go to the link of patreon.com that I've put up there, to where any donation you send through Patreon, half of that will go, of course, to Give Kids the World, which you can find out about that also on the website, neverlandpodcast.com, where I also have a link for that. You'll also look in the show notes for anything that might be available on iTunes. Since we're going to talk a lot about Darkwing Duck, I will find a link for you can purchase some Darkwing Duck episodes, provided, of course, iTunes has it available. I'll link it up for you so you can just conveniently click right there. And, of course, everything you do there does help out the show. But that's enough of me flapping my gums. How about we move on to some of this great content, the conversation I had once again with Jason from DAF Radio, Gary from Saturday Morning Rewind, and, of course, voice actress Katie Leigh. Enjoy.
To Disney and beyond.
Welcome, 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 Leverlanders. We have ourselves a nice little panel set up right here. Well, let's go with us, you know, just to introduce and go around the room of who we've got with us. We'll go with us, our minor league, our little podcasting groups here. Of course, y'all know me. I'm the Pan. You've been listening to me already in this show. But over here, we're going to say to my virtual, let's see, if I was sitting on the map, that's over to my left. to the west of me, we have Jason from the DAF Radio podcast. Say hello.
How's it going? Hey, how's it going?
And then over to my virtual right in the podcast universe, over from Raleigh, North Carolina, we have Gary from the Saturday Morning Rewind podcast.
Hey, everybody.
Hey, Gary.
Yeah, and, hey, of course, there's that other voice you just heard. She's back again. One of the first big guests we had on the Neverland podcast, voice actress extraordinaire, Katie Leigh.
Woohoo! Hi. Hi, everybody.
Yay.
Thanks for having me back on it. That's nice.
Yes. And we've had Katie on here, and all of us, three of us as fans and one of us as someone who knew this person. But we have wanted to pay tribute on somebody who was really, in a lot of ways, meant a lot more to us than I realized when the more I've learned about her career. But Christine Cavanugh passed away this past December the 22nd. And I tell you what, when I first heard about this, I remember reading on Facebook, Rob Paulson had posted, "Rest in peace, Christine Cavanugh." And I was like, well, I wonder who that was. I wonder, was she another voice actress that he had worked with? And then as I started seeing other posts up there, started seeing pictures of Goslin and Chuck from Rugrats. I'm a good speaker. This is why I work in podcasting. And then, of course, Babe and just all kinds of different things. And I was like, oh my goodness, this is kind of a big loss.
Please, do not push the button. You have no idea what it does.
And I'm so young too. But so we've got to have a panel here so we can kind of share memories of watching her work, and Katie can share, of course, of working with her. So
yeah,
I guess we'll start with you, Katie, since you met her long before we knew who she was.
Yeah, I had even watched her on TV before I ever worked with her, because she was on a Nickelodeon show when Nickelodeon was new, called Salute Your Short. She was an on-camera actress too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's funny. She was really funny in that show. And then, but I think Darkwing Duck was her first animated job. Her first job in animation was playing Goslin on Darkwing Duck. So that was fun, because I hadn't ever met her when we did that. She was new to the business, and she was just so sweet. I mean, her, someone else, another director, posted something on Facebook that I have to agree with, that her performances were always really surprising. Her take on things was different and fresh and unique. And she just had this energy. I just love the way she would talk and how her lips would, you know, when she was doing Goslin's voice. And you know, Goslin had that sort of tomboyish, they might call it tomboyish attitude, but she was just like this really forthright kid who just, you know, took life by, you know, the horns. And I loved her portrayal of Goslin because she was just so funny. She's like, just, and she'd have all this energy. It was great. And of course, my character was a lot calmer compared to hers. So,
but you really played off of each other, though. Yeah.
Did they have you audition together at any point before they cast you both as Honker and Goslin?
No, I think we met, you know, at the studio, like usually happens. Like, you get to work, and they say, okay, this is who's playing this is playing that. No, they don't have people audition together for animated stuff. No, that's pretty rare. People might, actors audition together for commercials, but not for animation.
Yeah, but you guys had such a great kind of, I guess, the chemistry and everything, the way Honker and Gosling's interaction. It was just like, it was so believable, you know?
Gosling was a leader, and in a way, you know, Honker was a little bit of a follower. So he was just there for her and, you know, keeping things calm. But, you know, it wasn't until when Darkwing Duck came out on DVD, and when I started doing conventions a couple years ago, and I needed to make pictures, you know, to autograph. And so I opened up my sealed box of Darkwing Duck, and, you know, we couldn't watch those things back in the day like you can now. And I put in the DVD and started watching the episodes. And when you're recording it, we always thought about, you know, who's the bad guy? Who's our guest star? What's the show about this time? But when I was watching it about a year and a half ago, I thought, wow, this is really about a great relationship about a father and a daughter. More than anything, it was the writing just blew me away. The performances, the animation, and that's what struck me this time watching it, was because, you know, I probably didn't even watch it that regularly, you know, once it was in the can, you know. But now I think, wow, that was a really special, what a great relationship those two had. And it was, I'm so honored to be associated with it, because it was so much more than just who the bad guy is this week.
Yeah, that's something I had missed out on, because I had only seen so much Darkwing Duck when it was airing, and then I was writing a review of an episode for Jason's website for DAFradio.net, I think it is, or is it a .com?
Yeah, .net.
.net. But I went and checked out from the library the first season of Darkwing Duck, and I had actually never seen the two pilot episode. I believe it was a two-parter, I think, yeah, because part three with
it was written.
But I had not seen how Gosling had came into the family. I had often watched Darkwing Duck before, and thinking, well, whatever happened to Gosling's mother? And then finding out that she had been this orphan that Drake Mallard had taken in. And so you got, like, this kind of new family, and it really brought out a different side for Drake Mallard, because at the beginning of the episode, he's all about his training in this crazy way that he's fixing his own breakfast and timing himself.
Right.
It was hilarious.
He has to take care of a little kid.
Yeah, and then Zali's got this little girl, and it completely changes his life. And you hit it right on the head. It really, the heart of it was really that relationship with him and Gosling. And then suddenly you bring in Honker and his family, and you've got like this regular world type of thing with his crazy best friend Launchpad. And then
Zali's turning around and doing hair repair. From the actors, I had the same father as Gosling, because Jim Cummings played Honker's dad too.
Yeah, that's true.
Right.
Yeah.
And the uber talented Jim Cummings, that it was such a completely different kind of voice and style.
Right.
It was so funny.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I agree with Katie that, you know, when I was a kid and I watched Darkwing first run, and I watched, I think, every episode as a kid, I loved that show, you know. That it was more about the villains, I think, for me, you know, like, ooh, what cool villain is Darkwing going to fight today, you know? But looking back as an adult, it's more about Darkwing and Honker and Launchpad and Gosling, this, like, family unit, you know? And I really think that, you know, Terrence McGovern, you know, Jim Cummings, Christine, you know, you, Katie, you know, it was a really talented cast. You guys did a really amazing job. And I think that is ultimately what holds up the best with that show.
Yeah,
and the fact that it was hilarious.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was pretty funny. It was very funny. And yeah, it was the first time I think we did a series for the Disney Channel, a new animated series for the Disney Channel, not ABC Family or whatever Disney owned, you know, network wise. It was for the Disney Channel. That was, yeah, I think the first one. And then, of course, you know, Christine went on to do all kinds of cool stuff after that.
Oh, yes. Now, I got to go pick on the first major thing, that, although that is not probably quite in order, but the major thing that sticks out for me is Babe. She was so great in that. And the main thing that sticks out for me, and I'm going to find a sound clip of it, although it will stab me right in the heart every time I hear the clip. But the way she had just enough of a cry in her voice when at the beginning of the movie, when Babe is there with the dog that's kind of taking Babe in, and just says,
"I want my mom."
That over time, it just rips my heart out.
Oh, and I could totally see it, because I can see Chrissy with her little lip wavering, because she was, really, her lips were very expressive. That sounds weird, but if you watched her perform, she had this kind of gangly body that, you know, she was wiry and tough, but she had it's funny when you go to imitate somebody, you always look at how they form their words and how their faces look, how their bodies move. And she just had it was in her lips with a lot of her acting. You could hear that with her crying too, right?
Yeah, with just her voice, she could make me cry. Because I tell you what, I can't get through Babe without being like all pixie dust in my eyes and everything.
Baram you.
Yeah. Oh,
it's
such
funny because Tim and I did a, for the Saturday Morning Rewind, our most recent podcast, we did an in memoriam for the voice actors that we lost this past year. And we opened it with her singing Little Girl Blue from Darkwing Duck, which was devastating. Because there's so much emotion in that song when she sings it, especially now, you know, after the fact. Mm-hmm.
I think that's what was so stressful. I mean, sometimes people don't understand, because we think cartoons or voiceover, what an easy job. But if you relate to your characters and it's very energetic, it can take a lot out of you. And it sounds crazy to come home and complain. It's not complaining, but just say, I'm really exhausted from what I did today. And I think that was stressful for Chris. It's a lot of, you know, it's a lot of work, because she did put a lot of, you know, energy. All her characters were extremely, you know, high speed. And I think even, you know, Babe Nobody emotionally, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So that's, you know, I think that's one of the things that she got tired of is, you know, you have to be on. It's you know, when you go to work, you got to put everything aside, and it's lots of energy and focus. And usually, you know, it's great. It's fun. But she was in a lot of things at the same time. And, you know, who knows? Nobody really knows too much about her personal life. I don't even know if I ever met her husband at the time. We used to talk about him. But, you know, it was stressful. I know part of it is why she left. I don't think she didn't like what she was doing, but it just was, you know, unpredictable and stressful.
Well, you know, she at least had enough of a body of work that's going to live on for a long time, though.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I really believe a lot of the characters she created, they're with us for a long time. I think a lot of them still hold up and they matter today.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Although I completely missed Rugrats. single episode. I feel like I must have missed out on something.
You know, I feel the early seasons were the best. That's just my take on that show. But, you know, it's interesting to me also. This is how I personally found out that Christine passed away. And I think that this really testifies what a, you know, major figure she was in the lives of, you know, the children of my generation, you know, or, you know, Gary or Jeremy. I found out through Facebook, you know, through the little news feed. And if you know how those things work, it's based on how many people are, you know, typing about it on their Facebook page, you know. And
I have no idea how those things work.
Yeah, no, that's totally how that actually works, is that it's all based on, you know, how many people on Facebook are writing about this article, you know, this bit of news. And so
I thought it was if your friends write about it.
Yeah. So the fact that she was like in the top three for a while when that, when the news first broke, you know, I really think that points out how much, you know, her fans care about her. You know, I posted on our Facebook page, on the Disney Afternoon Forever Facebook page, you know, kind of a, my own little tribute, you know, thanks for the memories. And I was just amazed at how many likes that thing got in such a short amount of time. You know, and I've gone to other websites and other fan sites, and it's just, you know, she was a very beloved figure to her fans. So,
well, she was, you know, just a really total professional. You know, nobody could ever say anything bad about her. She just came in and did her work. But she, you know, wasn't big into the Hollywood aspect of, which most voiceover actors aren't anyway. But even, you know, just totally, you know, not, just enjoyed doing what she did and living her life, and very professional, always pleasant. You know, you won't find anybody say anything, you know, bad. That's why she was so missed. Like, wow, you know, why did she leave us? She left us when she moved away, and that was the strangest thing. And just, without, she just cut ties with everybody.
And boy, the ongoing series, you know, with Dexter's Lab, which was one of my favorite cartoons, even as an adult when I started watching it, when she left, Dexter was never quite the same. The replacement voice was like, it sounds like Dexter, but it doesn't sound like Dexter. Just something was missing.
Well, and I think that that's the art of voice acting is, you know, you can, anybody can, oh, I can imitate this or that, but the actor brings so much to the role. You know, it's more than just a voice. It's a whole embodiment of a character. It's her, you know, her sense of humor, her, you know, timing, her whatever, you know. And that's why they say if you want to create a character voice, you should either do a really bad imitation of somebody who's famous or do a really good imitation of somebody nobody knows. But you'll never be exactly the same as, you know, anybody. It's your own.
Great advice. For me, I grew up watching Rugrats probably more than anyone else here. And I remember... Well, there were two things I was obsessed with, and that was, ironically, Rugrats and Adventures in Odyssey. So, with that, I grew up, or I think in the same year. This is Gary from Saturday Morning Rewind. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's a pleasure to talk to you.
Wow, yeah, pleasure is all mine.
but with Christine and with E.G. Daily, those were like two of the first names that I actually knew when I started delving into voice. And then, of course, with, you know, Katie Leigh and Will Ryan, et cetera, et cetera. And I can really thank her for turning me on to this world of voice acting. And it just really hit me hard whenever she died. And I guess I'd kind of forgotten a little bit because she hadn't been, you know, talked about in a while, but she died, it kind of brought back all the memories of how great she really was.
Right. Yeah, and you don't think about how much these voice actors, how big of an impact they have because you kind of grow up listening to them. I think I've almost gotten where I've kind of been able to focus more with, because also I love Adventures in Odyssey, and over the past few years, I mean, as the time I've listened, you know, like when Hal Smith passed away, and my goodness, I can't, my brain's gone out there, but so many people have passed. Yeah, Walker Edmonston, and the one that's just but more recently who was on the Partridge Family,
Dave
who
Madden.
Passed away, Dave Madden. My brain went out the window for a second. Thanks y'all for covering. But yeah, to have all these people pass away that, you know, through having listened to them on Adventures in Odyssey, that you get so used to the different characters, and then you find out of all the different, you know, the animation they'd worked on that you're like, oh my gosh, I used to watch that and I used to love that. And only recently when I did an episode here for Mickey's Christmas Carol did I realize that Hal Smith had even voiced Goofy in that, and even Will Ryan had been Willie the Giant at some point, and just all the people
actually,
who
Will's oh yeah Will's Pete too in that
And so, Alan Young wrote the movie, so
yeah. There's just so much great work, and I think it so often goes so unappreciated until you get maybe as an adult, and then you hear the voice of a voice actor, and you connect it with the characters you grew up with and loved as a child, or even as an adult who is a big child, you know, because I never grew up really, and so you have that connection. It's like, wow, these people really meant a lot to me, and even though I never ever saw their face, their voice, you know, is always going to bring back those happy memories of watching that animation or listening to something on the radio. You know, it's a very, very special thing. And so you really do kind of feel that loss. You know, it's I guess I can't quite fully equivalent it to Robin Williams because everybody felt that one around the world. But it's that same type of thing where they mean a lot to you, even if you never saw them, you know.
Yeah, I think that's very sweet. And I'm really thankful to get to hear that, because I think, you know, sometimes we're in our own little world. And the one good thing is, I think all the work that you mentioned, all the things that people do it because we like to do it. And, you know, there may never be an audience and we'll be happy. But then to hear that feedback later on, it's like, wow, you know, somebody else really, it means something to them, too. So that's nice.
Yeah, I think it's because as a kid, because voice acting is done so well as a kid, you believe those characters are real and no one can tell you otherwise. Like, yes, I see it's like a drawing that's moving, but it's real to you. And then as an adult, you realize, okay, well, this was a performance. And yeah, that's when you start really connecting. It's like, hey, there were people who really put a lot into it that you couldn't see them, so they had to put everything into their voice to deliver that performance, to get across that emotion or to make you laugh in some fashion. And it's really something. I think that's why I whenever you can see clips at conventions and they have some voice actors in, that there's people who are just like, they were the voice of who? Oh my goodness. And everybody just like, oh man, I just can't wait to see them and I want to hear them talk and hopefully talk at some of the characters I love, and we get excited about it.
Well, there's something very intimate about your ears.
Yeah.
Very true.
See, and I think I'm just a geek because I was paying attention to all these voice acting names back when I was a little kid.
Well, you're one of us, obviously.
So, I mean, you know, I knew about all of you, Katie. I mean, I won't say all of you because even now, as I'm doing this podcast, I'm coming up to names. I'm like, whoa, no way, you know. Because there are a lot of voice actors, there really are, you know, and I don't think a lot of people realize that, but the ones that pop up a lot, you know, I knew about them when I was a kid, and so it was really a thrill as I'm starting to get to meet a lot of these voice actors, you know, and it's really awesome. I'm really sad I never got to meet Christine, but she sounds like a really amazing person.
She was, and she was really very shy, because I don't know if you would have ever been able to meet
her. Yeah, I didn't know her
anyway. I think she, you know, she obviously had very close ties with her family in Utah. And, you know, she came out here. She came, she saw, she conquered, and she had enough.
I totally understand that.
I admire that, I guess.
No, yeah, definitely. Well, and that's one of the things I really love, and I kind of knew this anyway growing up in L.A. as a kid, but y'all are just people, you know, and you have lives, and you have kids, and significant others, and you have hopes and dreams, just like all the rest of us, you know, and the great thing about your job, though, is that you're able to transform that into a performance. You know, it's kind of cool, actually, if you really think about it.
Well, we're very fortunate in that, you know, until social media reared its ugly head, nobody saw what we looked like. Nobody knew who we were. And we really
did. I was going to say, I did because I bought that Adventures in Odyssey book. So So I saw your face back when I was like 10, and I was like, oh, that's what Katie Leigh looks like.
I know, that's funny. But I mean, normally, you know, we're pretty camera shy, so it's not unusual to have, you know, when you have a lot of attention turned on you, maybe like Christine, who may have been even more shy than some of the rest of us.
Well, and that's a good point. I'm actually just kind of connecting the dots here. Maybe this has nothing to do with it, but the time period that she retired is when the internet really started to pick up. Mm-hmm. Just putting that out there. I don't know. Maybe that was part of it too, is that pressure to be out there more publicly with the internet. Could be.
Well, it's kind of funny because she wasn't on camera actress. She wasn't on camera actress too. So
that's true.
You know, she had I don't know. You know, I really don't know. I just know that we've always missed her, always wondered how she was doing, what was going on with her, and it would have been nice to have news that, you know, she had accomplished something wonderful like climb Mount Everest instead of just finding out, you know, that she had passed away. Because it, you know, I hope that she knew that we missed her. I hope she knew that we cared about her and appreciated her. You know, but because I know as soon as Facebook existed, I started looking for her, you know, to see if I could find her, or the internet when it started getting better. Like, where is she? You know, I'd just like to say hi. She got a little reclusive there.
Well, I guess probably only her family will know what was really going on, because there's rumors of she just wanted to spend more time with her family, which is totally respectable. And there's rumors of, you know, leukemia or who knows. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah,
and her family's going to know for sure.
You know, a lot of women, especially in the business, and, you know, I don't have to mention any names, but when you're close to them and they may be dealing with cancer or some other diseases, and when you're an actress, it's almost like, you know, it's kiss of death doesn't sound right, but you know, if anybody knows you're dealing with anything, it really can make people not want to work with you or think you're not healthy or whatever. So a lot of people go through things in this business that is kept secret. They're just, you know, getting by because, you know, I think I've mentioned before on one of your podcasts, maybe, you know, we get fired every day. There's no guarantee that we're going to have work, so that, you know, we have to always appear to be available, you know. And there was a time in my life when I was going through stuff and I wasn't very available, and it changed, you know, I think in some respects the course of my career, because
the talent isn't all that matters. There's a lot of other factors as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, you know, who knows if you're dealing with something that you don't want people to know about, it can, you know, that's the one thing, you know. You may not be rich in this business, but you can definitely be famous.
Yeah. We've had that discussion before, Katie. Rich and famous. I know about that. But
yeah.
You know, I'm really happy though that a lot of these performances Christine gave are on DVD. Not all of them, you know, but a lot of them are, and that's great. You know, it's a great way that it will continue, you know, this work that kids that haven't even been born yet will get to enjoy her voice acting talent, and I think that's awesome.
Yeah.
Yep, because, well, if I had any kids, but I could share it with my kids, and then they could grow to love it and share it with theirs. And everything's going digital now, so it's all going to be stored somewhere on some massive computer, you know, that you can always just share it with the next generation down.
Well, I wish I could give you guys a little bit more insight into Miss Chris, but, you know, just know that there's anything good you read about her is all true.
I'm curious, since we have you on the phone here and we're talking about this, what was your favorite memory with her working on Darkwing Duck?
Oh, gosh. Man, it was a really fun show to do. I just think I don't have one specific memory, just working with that, you know, her energy, just being surprised at how things would come out. And then I think when we finally got to see it animated, because you never know how it's going to look until it, you know, happens, right?
Yeah.
And then to see how perfect her voice was for how they animate. That's always the great thing about it, to see how that comes out, you know. So I think that is a great part of working with somebody and seeing how the final product comes out, because that's always really exciting. So, you know, I think a hugger would be so very sad just to, you know, because he's always going to miss her because they're very best friends.
Yeah. I think we're all going to miss her, too. I guess we've been missing her since 2001 when she retired.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, but for one last thing, though, definitely, Dee Dee, get out of my laboratory.
Dee Dee, how many times have I told you to stay out of my freaking secret laboratory?
I know. When I saw Dex, oh my goodness, I was like, oh, that is hysterical. Yeah. I mean, really, she had a lot of stuff in her. You know, when you first work with somebody, sometimes people get a gig, you know, it's their first animated show, and you think, okay, well, this is great. I wonder if they'll be able to sustain, you know, or book another, because, you know, every series, it's a new experience, you audition. And then it was like, who is playing Dexter? And when I saw it was Chris, I'm like, oh my gosh, I never would have imagined her doing that. And, you know, you just don't know what people have inside of them. And, you know, and you, at least, you know, in animation and voice work, people who are talented like she was have the opportunity to express those things that are inside that, you know, you wouldn't get to do just on camera. And I was really impressed. I thought that was hysterical.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely hysterical.
And one of the things I always, it was probably one of my favorite episodes of Dexter's Laboratory, for as much as Dee Dee would drive him crazy, the one episode where he finally gets Dee Dee and like she's fired out of the lab, and he's trying to rehire a new person to kind of disturb him because he realized he can't work without some sort of chaos behind him. And so he realizes he needs Dee Dee in there to destroy his stuff just so he can focus on his work.
That's so funny. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that one.
That was probably the greatest episode, because like, this is why we keep watching, because Dexter doing his crazy stuff, but there was that great brother and sister that, as much as Dee Dee annoyed him, you knew there was that sibling love was going on.
Mm-hmm. And that's good writing too, when you get those combinations of, you know, great characters and great writing, you remember it.
Yep.
It touches you. It's, you know, you guys are still talking about it, so it means something, right?
Yep, I'll probably be 70 or I'll still be talking about cartoons I watched. Philip, Lost Boy Phil, for anyone who listens to my show regularly, will appreciate this picture that he got me, that I've have now on my wall for Christmas. It's a drawing of Peter Pan with Wendy, John, and Michael, and it says, "Grow wise, grow strong, but never grow up."
Like,
that's exactly. I'm going to grow wiser, stronger, and older, but I'm never truly going to grow up. I'm going to, you know, keep that pixie in my pocket and that good attitude and share it with others and keep that youth going as long as I can until I'm in my grave, and then I'll just transfer and I'll go to heaven and I'll be a big kid there.
Well, you know, I still, you know, repeat cartoons I watched when I was a kid that stuck with me. So, yeah. I get little phrases. Oh, yeah. I mean, cartoons are a huge part of your life. If you're one of those people that watched them, I mean, and we're all, especially if you come to work with us and see, you know, any scene or something reminds us of something we saw in a cartoon, or there's something, you know, a crisis is going on. Somebody might yell, "Help, Cecil, help." You know? You know what I'm referring to. You may not. That's my cartoon growing up, Beanie and Cecil.
I think I've heard of it, but I've never seen that one.
Oh, you better. Okay, I highly recommend. Now that there's YouTube, you can see everything. Watch Beanie and Cecil. Absolutely. I mean, one of my favorites growing up. And then when I did work with Walker Edmiston, it turned out when you work with these old timers and they fill you in on the real history, Beanie and Cecil was a puppet show originally. And Walker was one of the puppeteers. And, yeah. Yeah, there's some history for you guys to look up.
Yeah, I guess so.
Cecil the sea serpent. Yeah. Very funny. And was it, was Dawes Beanie's voice? I think so. Yeah.
Referring, of course, to Dawes Butler, or should I say the great Dawes Butler.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, I will always love best for Yogi Bear.
That was a very satirical cartoon. You should watch it and do a little show on it and inform your listeners.
Oh, it's definitely something fits in the alley of my podcast because I go Disney and beyond, so I don't have to stick to Disney stuff. Woohoo! I cheat.
cheater.
Well, yep. I'll tell you how you can combine, because they did an episode of Beanie and Cecil I saw when I was playing around YouTube once about Disneyland, but it was called Ditzyland, I think. So you have that, yeah. So there's an overlap there. They made fun of a lot of stuff. A lot of very fun. Well, I think Stan Freeze was in there too. So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. So what was some of other your favorite cartoons when you were a little girl?
Well, I used to watch Davy and Goliath. That's not a cartoon, but with Hal Smith.
It's animation, so it works.
Okay. Gumby and Pokey. I was a big Gumby and Pokey fan.
Yes, I love Gumby. Oh, they used to show that even when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
I actually have a Gumby figure on my wall.
who did we watch that I would... now, of course, my mind just went blank.
You had to watch Jay Ward stuff, Rocky and
Bullwinkle. Oh, yeah, Rocky and Bullwinkle. Yeah, exactly. Okay, that was it. Yeah, Fractured Fairy Tales. I mean, you got every character that has ever been done since is pretty much based on one of those characters, right? Yeah, totally.
And the legendary June Foray.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mighty Mouse. I used to watch Mighty Mouse.
Yeah,
here I come. But I like the funny ones. I like the Rocky and Bullwinkle, the stuff that had more adult humor, I guess. Oh, puns. I like puns. So if you watch Beanie and Cecil is hysterical. It's full of puns and adult humor. And even though I was a kid, I guess I mean, some things you don't get till you're older anyway, right?
So yeah.
Oh, I said those are the signs of a good cartoon.
Yeah, right.
Whenever I watch it as a kid and laugh, and then I watch it now, and I'm like, wow, that joke went completely over my head, and I still laughed.
yep, exactly. I mean, and so some of the Warner Brothers, you know, were like that too, right? Bugs Bunny and that. But, I would rather see something that was witty than watching things blow up. You know, like even Wile E. Coyote was fun, but not as clever as... Yeah. I don't know, for some reason I got that humor when I was younger.
That's the great thing about Bugs Bunny is that he's kind of both, you know. Things blow up, but he's also witty.
But Yogi Bear, I mean, those were funny.
Yogi Bear is witty, yeah.
And a good healthy dose of the Flintstones. I watched all kinds of Flintstones when I was a kid.
Yeah, they're funny stuff.
Yeah, that's the shame of today is now that you really have lost Saturday morning cartoons and even like the afternoon cartoons where you'd come home from school where they used to show a lot of those older cartoons and the syndicated cartoons. Now all you've got is Cartoon Network and the new breed of cartoons, which to me, I just don't seem to have the same appeal. And even Boomerang is showing more recent ones that still have some good ones, like Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends. I thought was great, innovative, and hilarious. I loved that show. Mm-hmm. And it's great to see some of the I call them the modern classics now, still getting around. But you really miss out on a lot of stuff. I mean, when I was a kid, you know, on the Disney Channel, you could watch Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck, and you could watch those classic cartoons. Now, unless you're willing to spend about $50 to $70 somewhere on eBay, you're never going to be able to watch a classic Mickey Mouse cartoon. And, you know, if it weren't for Boomerang, there's no one who actually shows any of the classic Looney Tunes anymore. And those used to be common.
Well, that's probably because everything, even before it gets on TV, ends up on YouTube. So it's hard for anybody to own anything.
Yeah.
You know,
That's my frustration. That's my frustration with, I mean, not just the Disney Afternoon cartoons, which is kind of my focus, but just any of the cartoons, even like the classic Disney shorts or the Warner shorts, or, you know, I understand that a lot of the studio executives want things to go digital, you know, and I'm not necessarily a fan of that, but I understand that. But then they don't put the stuff out there. Like, really? I mean, just I hate the idea of these classic cartoons collecting dust and no one enjoying them anymore, because I just feel like that was the point in making them, was to have people enjoy them, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's been so long since I've seen Woody Woodpecker. It's sad.
Oh, Woody Woodpecker. I used to love Woody Woodpecker, too. Yes. But, I mean, that's the thing, though. You guys have to, you know, bottom line, nobody made anything unless they thought it would make money, okay?
I know that.
It's a business, and all this, you know, internet stuff has kind of changed, you know.
No, it's changed the business.
People are trying to figure out, what to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, just about all the shows I've worked on that I think were pretty amazing with, got to work on with, you know, my idols, they don't mm-hmm. show them. Nobody knows they existed. Except your age.
Yes, I think our age was the last age to know about these really classic cartoons. And I think all the kids since don't know who Yogi Bear is or Rocky and Bullwinkle, or, you know, they're just, who are those guys, you know? And I think that's really sad. I really do.
Well,
yeah.
Anyway,
it's great, that's though, okay, that the stuff that is out there is out there, and that, you know, as time marches forward, these performances, there are still ways for people to enjoy them, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And even though, you know, and I mentioned this when, after Robin Williams passed away, because I also talked about other, not just voice actors, but just people behind the scenes that worked on these shows, you know, the Disney Afternoon show specifically, but it goes for anything, you know, like James Avery, we lost him, I think, about a year ago, you know, and besides doing Fresh Prince, he did a lot of voice acting too. The thing is that, exactly. You know, the thing is, though, is that because of this particular profession that, you know, Katie and all these people are in, there's a little bit of immortality there. You know, I can pop in my Darkwing Duck DVD and Christine's there. You know, there's dogs, you know, and that's really special. That's really awesome. You know,
what's great, too, is that I don't think, I'm just going to say this and then I'm going to have to say goodbye, but it occurs to me that what is so amazing and wonderful about being a voice actor is that it doesn't matter as you get older. People don't look at it later and say, oh, I see what this person looks like now, you know, like an on-camera mm-hmm. actor, and you know, and then they look at you and, wow, they're really old. Because the voices, that our voices don't normally change that much, and the animated characters don't get old. So they don't have that kind of, the performances you do on camera. If you look at Dustin Hoffman now and you look at him in the past, like, wow, that's the same guy, or it's dated. When it's animated, I don't think it gets as dated. If the humor, you know, if the stories are good and the voices are good, they have a little bit more longevity, I think, and less judgment. I don't know if judgment's the right word, but they're not viewed in the same light as films.
Yeah, I agree. I was watching some of the classic Donald Duck shorts not too long ago, and I really feel that a lot of them still hold up today. I really believe that, you know.
Oh yeah, especially when he's really trying cool. to make waffles and he puts glue in the dough. I love that one.
Exactly. So
nobody says, "Well, I don't want to listen to, you know, Donald Duck because he's old now."
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. You know, the age of the actor, the personality of the actor, whether we're alive or dead, doesn't change the appeal of the show.
Yeah. Yeah. Funny is always going to be funny.
Mm-hmm. Well said. Well said.
Voice acting is kind of a way for immortality, so to speak.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I guess.
Mm-hmm. And it's also... It's that great way to reach somebody when they're very young and they can stay with them all the way till they're an adult, because you can just always have that voice always there.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
And I have many of them.
Well, thanks, you guys. I have got to say goodbye, so I'll let you carry on if that's okay.
All righty. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show again.
Thank you. It's nice to talk to all you guys. God bless. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay. Well, we'll go ahead and wrap this up by once again going through our round circle here. So we had Jason tell everybody a little bit about your show and your website.
DAF Radio, or Disney Afternoon Forever. That's what the DAF stands for. We are all about the Disney afternoon. So... You know, we were talking about Katie Leigh, and she worked on Gummi Bears and Darkwing Duck, and you know, we're talking about Christine, and she worked on Darkwing Duck, and so we're all about focused on protecting the history and collecting the history of the first about decade of Disney television animation, otherwise known as the Disney Afternoon for a lot of people at home, and we also are trying to get the DVDs released. So there are actually some more of the DVDs, the final volumes of Tailspin and Gargoyles and the first two of Goof Troop that are going to be released retail. They're already at Walmart, and in just a few weeks they'll be everywhere. So we're really excited about that.
And they can follow you on Twitter at DAF Radio, right?
That's right. Or just look on Facebook, Disney Afternoon Forever, or, of course, as you mentioned, on our website, which includes podcasts with interviews like with Katie Leigh. DAFradio.net.
And Gary, is a recent addition to the Saturday Morning Rewind. So tell us all about how people can listen to that.
Yeah, well, there's many ways. We are located on iTunes. Just do a search for Saturday Morning Rewind. We have a website, which is www.saturdaymorningrewind.com. And we have all sorts of things on there, including links to the podcast. We have reviews of cartoons, movies, video games, pretty much anything that you can think of. We also have an awesome tribute page and all sorts of pictures, cartoon trivia, and just a lot of stuff. We've recently created a Pinterest page that we're trying to get the word around. It's got a lot of pictures from Facebook and also some exclusive stuff over there. And we release two episodes a month. The first of the month, it's a conversation with Tim and I, and the second interview comes out on the 15th, and it's an interview with Tim and a voice actor. And it's not all Disney. Sometimes it's Looney Tunes or Warner Brothers.
Or G.I. Joe. That's the first episode I remember listening to. I was talking to the actor who portrayed Duke.
That's right. Michael Bell. Yep.
That was cool. I was like, it's Duke. The
first episode.
Yeah, I think it was. And he found out he was even a handy Smurf, and
that's right. And he was, in relation to Rugrats, he was Chucky's dad. So,
yeah.
Yeah, I think he was, yeah. So.
Yeah, wow, that's weird, huh? That's a great way to wrap things up.
The circle is now complete.
Yeah.
When I began this podcast, I was but the learner. Now I am the master. Okay. We couldn't get through a Neverland podcast without a good Star Wars quote, okay? So. All right. Well, and we can find Saturday Morning Rewind on Twitter as well, I believe, right?
Twitter and Facebook, yeah. Just do it. And we're probably the most active on Facebook, so definitely check us out over there.
Ditto
here. That is at Saturday Morning Rewind, or is that what the...
On Facebook, it's just at Saturday Rewind. And then on Twitter, it's at Saturday Rewind. On Facebook, it's Saturday Morning Rewind.
Yeah. Okay, so everybody, go follow. Your mission for the week. Go forth, follow, enjoy.
At last, my greatest work completed.
Thank you for listening to the Neverland Podcast. Please subscribe and rate the show on iTunes, Stitcher, and Blueberry. We love to hear from you on twitter.com/neverlandpcast and facebook.com/neverlandpodcast. Leave us a voicemail at 816-226-6492 and send email to podcast@neverlandpodcast.com. Join us next week and we'll once again go to Disney and beyond. The Neverland Podcast is copyright Glue Band Productions and all original content belongs to the same. Other content is copyright of their respective creators and is used under Creative Commons license.